In this first section, we will outline some of the most important things that we now know about cognitive functioning, or IQ, in individuals with 22q. Now, when I say cognitive functioning, which may be captured in IQ, what I mean is the overall level of thinking, of reasoning. And this has to do both with verbal and perceptual skills, as well as, for example, with memory and speed of thinking. Now, we start with this because it plays such a central role in other aspects of development and in our overall functioning as well. In this first section, I will be quite descriptive, while in the next section, I will go into more detail about what all this information means and why and how it is relevant in the daily lives of individuals with 22q. Okay, with regard to the characteristics of cognitive functioning in 22q. First, on average, people with 22q of all ages have a different level of cognitive functioning than people without 22q. If we look at IQ scores, we see that IQ is generally lower in people with 22q, on average about 30 IQ points. But still, even between individuals with 22q, there are substantial differences in their level of cognitive functioning, or IQ. So while most people with 22q will have an IQ of around 70, there are also some people with 22q and an IQ of 115, for example. Likewise, other people will have an IQ of 50 or even lower. A question that you may have then is what factors are influencing this large variability, these substantial differences between different people with 22q? We previously thought that the exact size of the chromosomal deletion, or perhaps specific genes in the region, would explain these differences. But decades of research actually provide no convincing evidence for this. It is likely that what we call environmental factors have some effect in shaping cognitive outcomes, even if it is modest. So, for example, you can think of what kind of school a child attends, what kind of playing materials are offered to the child, etc. So basically, factors that are relevant for any developing child. Also, we did recently discover that the level of cognitive functioning of the biological parents of someone with 22q plays a substantial role in shaping the cognitive level of the person with 22q. So in other words, the higher the IQ of the parents, the higher the IQ in the person with 22q, even though it will be, on average, about 30 IQ points lower. We are recently learning that this relationship between parental and child IQ, also in people with 22q, is at least in part due to genetic factors. So genes other than the 22q deletion itself that parents share with their child help shape the level of IQ in both parents and child. The second important observation with respect to cognitive functioning in people with 22q is that there are often large differences between different areas of cognitive functioning, or in other words, between the different components of IQ. As I said in the beginning, IQ refers to our overall cognitive thinking and reasoning abilities, and it includes skills in several different domains. So, for example, language-related skills, such as how well you can understand and explain the meaning of certain words, or how well you can understand how two different words are related, are captured in what we call the verbal IQ, or verbal reasoning. Other domains include performance IQ, processing speed, and working memory. Now, all these components combined determine one's overall level of cognitive functioning that can be captured in the full-scale IQ. In the general population, in one person, these different components of IQ are generally around the same level. So, for example, if you have a verbal IQ of 105, your performance IQ and processing speed and working memory scores will likely also be around 105. However, in people with 22q, that is frequently not the case, and there may instead be large differences between the different domains of cognition. Specifically, we know that the performance IQ in people with 22q is often substantially lower compared to the other domains of IQ. And we are also learning, only very recently actually, that these different IQ domains may have different developmental trajectories. That means that they develop and evolve in different ways as an individual moves from early childhood through middle childhood and adolescence into early and eventually advanced adulthood. And that brings us to the next observation, which is about the development of IQ over time. So again, in the general population, we know that IQ scores are generally very stable over time. So that means if a 7-year-old has an IQ of 85, they're likely to also have an IQ of around 85 when they're 16 years old or 35 or even 70. And that if in this person there is a substantial decline, that may indicate that there is something going on, underlying or acquired brain pathology. Now, of course, in all people, cognitive skills are expected to develop in childhood and also to deteriorate somewhat in older adulthood. But importantly, IQ scores are age-adjusted and account for that. An important observation in people with 22Q is that often IQ is not stable over development. Different trajectories of IQ are possible in this population, and here I would like to discuss a few trajectories that are most commonly observed in people with 22Q. And we will visualize these trajectories onto a typical developmental trajectory of cognition in the general population. So most individuals with 22Q demonstrate a trajectory of cognitive development that looks something like this. So they start out a little bit lower compared to people without 22Q, but then throughout childhood and adolescence, their cognitive skills go on to develop. So they acquire more skills. However, this learning of new cognitive skills happens at a pace that is somewhat slower than what we see on average in children without 22Q. And as you can see, that results in an increasing difference between the IQ of children with 22Q and their typically developing peers. The consequence for IQ scores is that in this trajectory, the absolute IQ score may decrease somewhat over time. But importantly, in most cases, this IQ decline, so to say, does not represent a true deterioration of cognitive skills, but rather a development whereby new cognitive skills are in fact being acquired, but at a pace slower than in typically developing peers. Very recently, integrating information from more than 1,300 individuals with 22Q, we created normative charts for cognitive development, especially for people with 22Q. So in other words, that's a sort of growth curve for IQ that tells us what IQ scores and what development of IQ scores over time is expected for someone with 22Q. It basically tells us what the average IQ score and average trajectory is for someone with 22Q, and whether or not someone deviates from that, and to what degree. With help of this norm chart, we can identify some trajectories that deviate from this typical 22Q IQ trajectory. The most notable one that occurs in a substantial minority of people with 22Q is that of a cognitive decline in excess of expectations, even for 22Q. So in these cases, what we see is at a certain point in development, cognitive development stagnates or even deteriorates. For people who demonstrate this trajectory, it may mean an actual loss of cognitive skills. So they may no longer be able to perform tasks that they previously could. The implication for the daily lives of such individuals with such a trajectory may be substantial and sometimes severe. We learned, for example, that this subgroup of people with 22Q, with cognitive decline, may be at a further increased risk for developing more severe psychiatric problems, in particular psychotic disorders. Multiple studies now have demonstrated that a more than expected IQ decline often precedes the onset of a full-blown psychotic disorder by several years. And this substantial cognitive decline could therefore be seen as a risk marker for psychosis onset in people with 22Q. Very recently, we also discovered that there's a genetic association between this more than expected IQ decline and psychotic illness. So we found that the genetic variants that collectively contribute to the risk for psychotic illness in people with 22Q also contribute to the risk for cognitive decline. Then, for another relatively small subgroup of people with 22q, the trajectory of cognitive development may look similar to what we observe on average in 22q, but with some meaningful small differences. The development of cognitive skills may advance at a pace somewhat faster than average, or some children may have a developmental delay but continue their development a little bit longer. While this small subgroup of children may seem more severely affected in early childhood, they may continue their cognitive skills well beyond what is typically expected, and may therefore catch up in early adulthood with their peers. So all in all then, here we see visualized what are some of the typical trajectories of cognitive development in individuals with 22q. And we see it plotted onto the average development in the general population, with the average trajectory of 22q and the cognitive decline one as the most common ones. All right, let us try to recap the most important observations that we discussed in this section on cognitive functioning in people with 22q. First, we saw that on average, their overall cognitive level, their IQ, is substantially lower, about 30 IQ points, than in the general population. But also that there are still large differences between different individuals with 22q. Second, we saw that the IQ profile is often very discrepant in individuals with 22q, with large differences between the different domains of cognitive functioning. And third, we saw that as opposed to the development of cognition in a general population, which is generally stable, there are different potential trajectories of cognitive development in 22q. And we discussed that the trajectory of a substantial decline in IQ, exceeding what we would expect given that someone has 22q, that such a decline may be a risk marker for future psychotic development and therefore may warrant additional care or monitoring, which we will further get to in section 2.